Good evening. Welcome to the Slap Horror Show.
Hello and welcome back to the On the Slab Horror Show, the show that we bring to you each and every, what day, Carl?
Friday night.
Why do we do it on Friday night?
Well, Friday night is horror night. Woo! Always has been over here in Ireland and the UK, so we keep to that. 10 p.m. Yeah. Every Friday, we put our show out like we used to get our horror shows every Friday night at 10 o'clock, and that's what the likes of myself and Greg grew up on. But
God bless the end of the watershed. and nowadays you have Sky Horror that shows them all day, every day. Mostly the same thing, but tonight we're joined by yet another cast member of the Mutilator 2, but it is the final girl from the original Mutilator as well, which, as everybody on this show will know, is one of my favorites. It's in my top five.
Yes.
That's how highly I rate it. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Miss Ruthie Martinez. How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
A lot better now. For me, as I said in the intro there, this is one of my favorite horror films. And to have a chance, I've actually had the chance to sit down with Buddy for a little while a couple of weeks ago. And I had to sit down with yourself, two people that were in the original one, that a movie that I love so much. And I'd say I've seen it easily 1,000 times.
Wow.
That's probably an exaggeration. I've seen it easily probably 100-150 times.
I wouldn't say Ruth gets that often. I'd say like that kind of dedication.
Like, I've watched it 3 times in the last 4 months.
There you are, you're back.
We lost you. I was saying this, I've probably seen it at least 150 times. I love it. It's great, and it's just one of them comfort movies that you just put on and sit into.
Comfort and a hug, huh? Comfort and a hug. Yeah.
It's actually a gaff.
There you go.
Just to be finickety. it's a great pleasure to have you on tonight. And we do thank you for taking the time out of your day to come on. Actually, looks like you have a nice day over there.
Oh, thank you. I'm sorry, my screen is freezing up a little bit.
No problem.
We were just saying thanks for taking the time out of your day to come on and whatnot. It looks like you actually have a nice day out there. I can see the light shining in from behind you, or it's a ring light, one or the other.
Oh well, both. It's nice here. We're not getting the snowstorm everybody else is, so.
Where are you based, Ruth, if you don't mind me asking?
I'm in Durham, North Carolina.
Oh, lovely. Lovely.
Nice.
Talk to the lady, will you?
I thought you were going to say something. So as I says, like, you were the star or one of the stars of the original Mutilator. How did you go about getting into that movie?
Well, I was a student at UNC Chapel Hill at the time, and I had just started studying drama, and I saw an ad in the paper, and it was an open audition call. I went, and it's interesting because Buddy actually sent me the original auditions, so I got to see those.
Kind of cool.
It was a little bit jarring to see all that, but it was fun. It was fun.
And Ruth, were you always a horror fan, or was that just like, it was like a good job that came up at the time, or?
It was, I'll be honest, I was never really into horror, but now that I've been in one and I've met all the fans, I mean, gosh, the horror scene is, you know, people are big fans in the horror scene, and I really love that.
Yeah.
It's very similar to the likes of Trekkies, Star Wars fans, comic book movie fans. They're so well knit in that it's probably one of the most loved genres. Like, it mightn't be as big a fan base, but they're certainly a lot tighter.
I sense that.
Yeah.
It's been fun.
And would you have like the same level of fandom, I suppose you could say, that you would have had back in the day, or would it be the same people, or would there be a younger crowd, if you get me?
Well, you know, it's interesting. Over the years, I've had the chance to go to different signings and fan events. And early on, not too long after we did the movie, there wasn't as much interest as there is now. Right. And I think it's because of that Blu-ray release that we did.
There was a Blu-ray release?
I don't know, about 8 years ago. It kind of brought in the movie. So yeah, I've noticed a big pickup in fans. I went to one event and I was shocked to see a line of people with things for me to sign.
So, brilliant. Like, you find a lot of, not forgotten horror films, but maybe not as popular as the big boys. They have such a really loyal fan base and a following, and I think that's it's real endearing, you know. I think it's fantastic, you know. And I think that can be more satisfying probably as you could tell me, I don't know, as an artist, you know, getting that kind of appreciation and love, you know.
Well, I call it my alternate universe, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know who I am, but, you know, it's kind of fun to go to these things. But I think, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, but maybe people have really realized how exciting the 80s were for special effects and those kind of films. Because now everything's kind of CGI'd, so, yeah. You know.
I know, it's overdone, it really is. I mean, I wouldn't be against like a happy medium of CG and practical, but practical for me is always the way to go. Yeah, that always has been, and we'll not say anything different on this show, so you're in good company with us here, you know what I mean?
All day, every day. and twice on a Sunday.
Absolutely.
Like CGI is good for certain things, but like in horror, if you have a monster and it's completely CGI, it takes you out of the movie completely. Mm-hmm. Like there should be somebody in a suit or an animatronic, like the Gremlins were, things like that should be done, even if you're using CGI as well.
It look better. We had some great artists that were kind of on the up and up working on Mutilator 1, and I just love the way it looks. So.
Oh, it's like even some of the death scenes in it were really well done. Like the when the cop gets killed outside the thing, when he gets the little broken piece of wood straight through the cheek, that's rough. That is rough. And then of course you obviously have the gaff hook scene, which is pretty visceral.
It was.
Yeah. Carl, that was the original Terrifier kind of way.
Yeah, what do you call it? The gaff hook?
The gaff hook, that's what it's called, yeah.
Gaff hook, right?
That's usually taking fish out when you're on the side of a boat.
Oh, right. Yeah. So that's I know the one you're talking about. I just called it a meat hook, did I?
Yeah.
It's so pointy. So
yeah.
And Jack nautical Chatham. Instruments.
Yeah. Jack Chatham was brilliant as Big Ed as well.
He is one of, if not the nicest guy I know. He's just a doll. So, you know, but to have him be the killer, it's kind of...
The killers are always the sweethearts in real life, aren't they?
He's a doll. He's just the sweetest man in the world.
You're definitely hearing that a lot more now. Like, obviously, people who play bad guys, like, we've heard it about David Howard Thornton, who obviously played Art the Clown, and he's now the mean one as well. Apparently, he's one of the nicest people you'll meet outside of things and especially stuff like that. It's great to see and it's great to hear. The whole premise of that movie, they show you who the killer is straight away. Yep. And there's no beating around it. It's just, yeah, this is what's happening.
Dad's having a bad night, yeah.
he's had a bad couple of years, really. I mean, he comes home to find his wife shot in the back by their own kid by mistake. On his birthday, nonetheless.
And you know, all of those folks were Buddy's family.
Oh, wow.
So, the mom is his ex-wife, and his son was the son.
Yeah, the young fella, yeah, he was telling me that I didn't know that at the time. It's great to keep people around, really, isn't it? But like, would you have kept in contact with them?
I have kept in contact with a fair amount of folks from M1 over the years. And once again, you know, we've occasionally done little events through the years, and so I get to reunite. It's always fun.
That's great. So what, it's coming up on what, 40 years now, is it? In 80...
Wow.
86, is it?
Jesus.
We actually shot in 83, so yes, it's coming up on 40 years now.
Wow.
Nice little reunion on the way at one of the conventions.
Yes, yes.
Or okay. All of the conventions.
Well, I reunited with Bill and Matt, and we did Camp Blood in Pennsylvania earlier in the fall. So that was a lot of fun.
I've heard really good things about that convention. It's one of the names that keeps popping up. Obviously, Scarefest, I think, is in Texas as well. We get in Ireland, there's a horror con that lasts, I think, six or eight hours, and that's it for the year. but there is one of the biggest ones in Europe is in Manchester, which is only an hour away from us on a plane. It's called For the Love of Horror. Big shout out to the lads. They do a stellar job with that. We're actually heading over to it this year for the first time. We're going to a con.
Oh, wow.
I've never been to a convention at all.
Me either.
This kind of way.
They do one here in North Carolina called Mad Monster Party. And I've been to that one a couple of times. Last time I went, I got in the elevator and somebody came in a scream outfit with a scream mask. And I'm like, wow, this is...
Brilliant.
Oh, it was Kate Kiddo and Chaney Morrow that were at it, but just not long after we were talking to them. They were down at that one.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
They're obviously from Jeff Siemens film Terror Trips.
Yes.
Chaney is obviously in Mutilator 2 as well. Mm-hmm. But like they were telling me about it and I was like, Jesus. We're really, really starved over here.
Very much so. Yeah. That's why we have to do our own podcasts, you know?
Yeah. But come November now, when we get over to this other one now, it's going to be a whole different ballgame.
Absolutely. Ruth, tell us what it was like filming the film. Give us a little bit of history, a background on your experience on the film.
Well, once again, I was in college at the time, and so they did some other scenes before I got there. When I got there, I remember they took me to the special effects room, and basically all these body casts of people and prostheses and things were there, and
wow.
That leaves an impression. But it was great fun. The thing that actually strikes me about both of the shoots is how fun they are and how much of a tight-knit group we had on both shoots. M1 obviously had a much smaller cast, so we really bonded. We were a team working on that, and we those first shots that are that the fall break song is playing over.
That's brilliant. It's perfect.
They were so much fun. They were so much fun, and we were actually drinking beer.
Nice.
Got to do it.
What I've noticed is that opening scene.
And there's a shot where it comes out of the car and yeah, jumps out of the car and believes himself, and that was all improvised, and they kept it.
Oh, deadly.
that opening scene where you're kind of driving off with the music in the background has been done quite a lot since then. Obviously it might be to that, it might be to other movies as well, but the most recent one I can remember really was Cabin in the Woods, doing it where they go in the camper van, where they're going off. No, it's a different song, but it's the same premise. You just see them driving off and whatnot, going off to a cabin. Do you know what I mean? Like, obviously there's been loads of them, but
yeah,
it was
that would go from Morehead City to Atlantic Beach. And we were going to try to film the final scene on that bridge, and they wouldn't let us. But they let us shut it down at rush hour to do that, those opening credits.
Nice. That's something, I suppose.
But most of the shoot was at night. So we would wake up 3 in the afternoon, have dinner, and then go shoot at the condo for most of the evening. So, and then we'd get up. There was a place to have breakfast at the pier. We'd have breakfast and go to bed. And that's how the month went.
That sounds actually nice, because I'm a night worker myself, so I just work nights, so that sounds like the best way to act. Yeah, nighttime. That's the way I would look at that.
Well, it was the month of May, and I was shocked when I went back in the month of May later, and there were so many people there, because I don't remember.
So obviously, that was Mutilator 1, and that went on to be a big success. And it was kind of strange, obviously, that time of horror. If one movie was a success, normally others followed off the back of it. For this to not have a sequel up until now was very strange. Was there any reasoning to that?
Well, it was a different time when we released M1. It was before they even had video, really. And so it was just released in the theater. And once it kind of came and went in the theaters, as far as I knew, it was a done deal. But then later it started appearing in video. And I was a teacher for years. And I remember one day I was in class and some of my students were like, did you do a movie? I was like, maybe, why?
Them questions normally end badly.
I was shocked. There were people doing tours of where we shot the movie on YouTube, and you know, fans that had posts about the movie, and I was, I couldn't believe that. So I think that the movie kind of gained ground through social media and YouTube and that kind of thing, led to doing the sequel now. I think we were originally supposed to do it in 2020, but pandemic, so
yeah,
we shot in spring.
So like I've said it a few times on the show, it was actually Eva Hamilton put a post up about Mutilator 2, and I was like no. So I had to actually get in contact to find out if it was the second one. I was like, already just making it a number 2 and they're just gonna reboot it. And I was like, she's like, no, it's a new one. I was like, holy shit. I was like, I'm on it. And I scoured through everybody.
And he's been taking you all out ever since.
Yeah. It was actually a shout out to Anna Clary, who was the first one to come on from the cast. And then it spiraled from there all the way through everybody. Or almost everybody.
So let me ask you, Ruthie, is the second one a direct follow on from the first one, or is, would you notice if things have gone on in between in the time since then, or if you know what I mean? What I mean, but yeah, so like Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the 74 one was the first one. The one that they brought out last year, the shitty one, was apparently the second one, if you get me. And there was 40, so there's 40 euros in between it, the film. So do you know what I mean? Would you be, is there much of a background, years, whatever, is there much of a background of between one and two, if you get me?
Well, I guess that's more of a buddy question. From my point of view, the two movies are very different, actually. So we've sadly lost some of our cast members from M1. So it's without getting too spoiler about it, it's more of a meta kind of thing, movie within a movie deal.
That's what we keep getting told. It's a meta movie. So to me, it sounds like it's going to be somewhat screen based, the way they done it with Stab. But obviously, I don't want to know, because I'm gonna wait till it comes out.
Say nothing.
whenever that is over here, but
who knows?
I have no idea.
No. That's not me asking. That's just me saying in general. Because normally, if these kind of movies come out in the States, it's another while before we get them. So I'll have to wait. But how did you end up getting a call to go to Mutilator 2?
Well, it was interesting because I think it was like fall of 2021. I did a signing event with Jack Chatham and Bill Hitchcock, and we all stayed in touch after that. And you know, I was kind of hearing that maybe that might start happening again. And then we got the word from Matt Mittler that he wasn't going to be in the movie. And we were like, well, nobody's even talked to us yet, but they talked to us pretty soon after that. So, you know, we kind of heard that this was happening, but then we were finally asked to be in it. And Bill actually worked props on the movie, and he said, you know, Ruthie, it's going to be a really professional crew. This is a really professional movie. You should get on board. So I did.
Awesome.
And as obviously the details that came out when I first seen that they were making a second one, so not all the cast list had been named, and obviously yourself and Bill were named later on into it. So I was delighted when I seen the two names pop up. I was like, yes.
well, it was fun for us too. It's, you know, it's interesting. I had no nerves on the movie because for me it's like fell into your high school reunion, you know.
Yeah. Just a bit bloodier, yeah.
A little bit. Yeah.
So obviously
some people got bloodier than others, let's put it that way.
Yeah. Oh, so obviously Mutilator 1 had a smaller cast than 2. But which one was more fun to work on?
Well, I'm a little partial to M1. I still had a great time on M2, don't get me wrong. But I wasn't there for like 4 weeks of the filming, whereas I was there the whole time for M1. So, I had a great time on both movies. But M1, we were a family after that.
You were slightly integral to being in most of the shots in M1.
Had a lot of shots.
Just a small bit, you know, being the lead female in it and whatnot.
M1 is your baby, so to speak.
Well, I was proud that I was number 3 on the call sheet for M2. So
that's not far gone.
Nice.
Ruthie, what other, I know you were saying you weren't really kind of into horror or so, but like what other horror films do you like watching, or is there any particular ones? Or,
well, honestly, I you know, we talked about the American Werewolf in London. I like those kind of big blockbuster horror films, but I had never watched a lot of them until recently. And when we were on the M2 set, we had obviously a lot of horror fans that were making sure that me and Terry Kaiser and other folks that hadn't seen all the classics were well steeped in the classics. So we were watching Scream and, you know, all these other horror films. We would watch them outside right by the beach, and boy, what fun was that. It was
brilliant. And what kind of films would you be into anyway to watch? Like what's your favorite kind of films? Like what you know, what really gets you going?
I'm a rom-com person. I mean, rom-coms.
Do you know something? There's a really good rom-com in horror that you probably have seen. I don't know, called Shaun of the Dead. You should watch that.
Okay, I'm putting it on my list.
Oh, you'd love that. And it's got horror, so you could even say that to your fans. Yeah, I've watched Shaun of the Dead. There you go.
Somebody made a YouTube cut of Mutilator 1 that tried to make it look like a rom-com.
Oh really?
I mean, there is sort of rom-com elements to it. There's obviously the two couples that are in it, and things. It could be very easily construed as a romantic horror kind of way, if you cut it properly, like.
Not if you call it the Mutilator, you can't. The Mutilator.
You just said there's a rom-com called Shaun of the Dead.
Yeah, I know, but Mutilator is a lot more, you know, it's a lot more harsher. You
well,
know?
I mean, don't forget, it was originally called Fall Break.
Right.
You could do a rom-com called Fall Break now. Absolutely. you know. But yeah, no, I think I'd actually prefer a rom-com called The Mutilator anyway.
It's about the only rom-coms I want to see. But yeah, so like I'd actually heard Carl Grasso was telling us that they were watching movies outside and stuff, and he's saying sitting there, he was sitting with who did he say, was it Terry Kaiser watching Young Frankenstein?
Yes! Yay!
I was like, what a life.
Actually, Ruthie, Carl thinks he's this big movie star, right? So, you know, we're going to show him this. You know, put him in his place. Send a message to Carl there, will you? Thinks he's this
Carl
big
is
movie,
a movie
star.
Now,
big movie star.
You know, I've only seen Carl in one film, but he was awesome.
Oh, he had the shades on and all a few weeks ago on our show.
Don't mind them, Carl. This Carl's wrong.
I'm always wrong on this show.
Well, I have a funny feeling that the question that we're going to ask soon is going to go against me in this one.
Yeah. So do you want to ask it?
Yeah, sure. Have you seen American Werewolf in London?
Yes.
Have you seen Dog Soldiers?
No.
That's not so fair. Then, I know.
Yeah, we can't ask it again. That's the second person we've had on now.
We have this running question that we ask every week now. There's a bit of a back and forth between me and Greg about what's the best werewolf film. And I always go with American Werewolf in London, and he always goes with Dog Soldiers. Now, the funny thing is, we love both films. We both love them. So it's just, you know, we're just seeing who people think is the best one. So
not Teen Wolf.
Teen Wolf was good. That's a rom-com.
Yeah,
that's a rom-com. Michael J. Fox was very good in that.
So if you ever happen to watch Dog Soldiers, throw us a message and then tell me that it's not as good as American Werewolf in London, okay?
Because it's not. Or you tell Carl to shut up there and accept the fact that he's just wrong again.
Never. Actually, there's a question, Ruthie. Have you ever been asked to do like something like a werewolf film or anything mad like that, or, you know, after The Mutilator?
No, well, you know, I kind of fell into normal life after later. I got caught up in work, but now I'm retired and I am putting it out there. Please, 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 I'd love to be in more films, and I love doing horror.
Well, there you go.
It's just great fun. Sure, I've been background.
If she's
in
it, I'll watch it.
And if you're in it, I'll hear about it.
Locally shot things, but that's about it.
Yeah.
It seems like, obviously, being in North Carolina, there's a lot of indie horrors being made around there now.
Really is.
And a lot of really good ones, too. So I'd say you're in the right part of the world to start finding roles if you're actively looking.
I'm actively looking now, and that's one of the reasons I moved to the Raleigh-Durham area. Centrally located in the state, I can go down to Atlanta, I can go to Wilmington, I can go to the mountains, so...
I'll just nod and agree, because I have no idea where in the States that even is.
Ruthie, would there be many kind of scary areas around where you live, or, you know what I mean, like kind of haunted areas or anything like that you know of?
Oh, gosh. Well, I lived in Greensboro for many years, and we had a theater ghost at the Carolina Theater there. And I hear there's theater ghosts in the Raleigh-Durham area, too. There's a Carolina Theater in Durham, too.
Right.
And, you know, I hear about the theater ghosts.
Yeah, we just have banshees over here, you know. That's our big thing, is banshees.
Not from any Sharon, though.
No.
Is Greensboro where they filmed Blair Witch?
No, I don't think so.
Or is that where it's based? Oh, no, that's Maryland, isn't it?
Maryland, yeah.
We had Bull Durham and Last of the Mohicans and...
Great movie.
You know, a lot of TV shows in Wilmington.
Hmm.
A couple of good movies there that you mentioned. One of them was an Oscar winner, wasn't it?
Was?
Two of them were. Last of the Mohicans won Best Actor, I think. I think Bull Durham won one as well.
Ruthie, what would be your comfort film, like as Greg was saying, you know, What's your go-to? You know, it doesn't matter what it is. What is it? Tell us. Go on.
Oh, I like things I'm a Ron. So like When Harry Met Sally is one of my favorites.
I mean, it's not a bad film.
Yeah, it's not a bad film.
No. I'm trying to think of the one with Jack Nicholson and
As
Ryan
Good As
Keaton.
It Gets.
Uh-huh. I love those. They're great.
as soon as you said Jack Nicholson, it's the only one that he's been in. Oh, no, sorry. You could theoretically say that The Bucket List is probably a rom-com. There's a bit of a relationship between the two of them.
Oh, I need to see that one.
Have you ever seen The Bucket List?
Oh, that's a good film.
That was Jack's last role.
Ah. Morgan Freeman and Jack Nicholson, yeah. Very cool. Yeah,
amazing movie. again, not a horror movie, but a very good one.
We like talking movies in general, so.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh. But I think, well, what more can I say? I'm kind of just going along for the ride here.
He's starstruck here, believe it or not. Now, that sounds crazy, but he is.
Well, I've been more of a theater person over the years. I'm doing a play called Blood Wedding right now.
Oh,
so.
Cool. And obviously, that's not a rom-com, I presume.
No. Blood is involved.
Nice. And would there be a big theater scene where you are at the moment? Or
actually, yes. One of the reasons I came here is, I grew up here. But over the years, there are just so many theater companies, both professional and non-professional. Mm. And I like to sing and dance, too. So I do musical theater, too. And
brilliant.
So, yeah, it's just there's just a lot of opportunities here.
Awesome.
Kyle likes to think he can sing.
Well, people tell me I can, apparently, so I just go along with the flow, you know. yes, I'm a musician, apparently, so yeah.
A good one, too.
it's a good talent to have.
It sure is. But that's after piquing my interest there about, plays and that kind of stuff. It's have you done many over the years, or is that your main passion in terms of acting? And give us a little bit of history on that there, you know, your interests and that kind of stuff.
When I was doing Mutilator, I kind of switched to, I was a biology and drama major at Chapel Hill. And then I moved to Greensboro and I got my master's in acting and directing there. And so after I graduated, I kind of, once again, I needed to have a regular paycheck. So I gravitated into teaching. I've done acting a lot over the years, but mainly in theater. When there have been some films coming to the area, I've been in them. I did The Handmaid's Tale that was shot in Durham. And nice. I did one called National Lampoon's Pucked, which was probably John Bon Jovi's first movie.
Oh, good Lord.
Is Chevy Chase in it?
Huh?
Is Chevy Chase there?
No. If Chevy Chase
isn't there, it's not a National Lampoon. If it's not the Griswolds.
No, do you know what's funny? Imagine getting a choice between John Bon Jovi or Chevy Chase and being pissed off that it's not Chevy Chase. That's, to me, is normal, if you get me.
Well, I know about three John Bon Jovi songs, and I know more obviously as a musician, but Vampires he was brilliant in.
Yeah.
He started doing some acting.
He's not bad either.
Wonderful guy. Just really, really nice.
But what I will say,
over the years I've just been doing lots of theater and acting.
Lovely. But I have to say, and I'm not slagging poor old John, have you heard him singing recently though? Oh, good Lord.
Really?
Yeah, and I'm not slagging the guy, because like I do like some of his songs, but he can't hold a note anymore. It's a shame. Like, it really is.
But, I heard him on the radio.
Oh, yeah. No, but like there's a couple of videos, of course. Everyone videos everything now.
I can't stand that at concert. You see the person in front of you like this.
Yeah, but he can't do the high bits anymore, unfortunately. And he's getting the crowd to sing most of the song, and which is a shame, because like, you know, he always like, a lot of my family would have liked Bon Jovi over the years, and they would have went to all the shows over here, and they would have loved him religiously. So it's a shame when you hear stuff like that, you know.
Well, wonderful person. Wonderful person.
Yeah, yeah. But there you go.
I think we'll start to wind it down a little bit now. I don't want to hold you all afternoon.
You would if you could, wouldn't you, Greg? In fairness, now.
I would.
Well, I'll just leave the chat, will I?
Well, no, because then the recording will stop.
Oh yeah, I'll leave it running.
it's been a great pleasure to have you on. And as I said, for me to have yourself and Buddy come on at different stages was great. Like when we started getting guests, I never thought that I'd get someone from one of my favorite movies, let alone two people.
And we really, really appreciate that, Ruth. We really do.
So. Well, thank you. It's been a pleasure for me too.
Yeah, and hopefully every success with picking up new roles and stuff. Who knows? You could become the next Lin Shaye and just explode again into the horror world.
Yay!
I think you should.
I mean, it wouldn't be too dissimilar in a rise, really, if you think about it. Like, she was the teacher in Nightmare on Elm Street 1. And then kind of disappeared for a little while and done other stuff. And then all of a sudden, Insidious came back out and she just took off into the stratosphere again.
All it takes is the right place at the right time. And maybe that film could be the Mutilator too. And let's hope. Let's hope it is. Yes. Let's hope that it is. Let's absolutely hope that it is.
We're going to have one sad panda here.
But no, I mean, we on the slab are very supportive of the Mutilator, I think. Everyone knows that by now. And we will do everything we can to make sure that when the second one comes out, we're going to promote the crap out of that. So, absolutely. Absolutely. Everyone from the Mutilator, I have to be honest, everyone from the Mutilator family has been nothing but really amazing and gracious with their time and their discussion. So we're really, really appreciative of everyone.
We're still in contact with a lot of them as well.
Yeah,
still in contact with all of them.
They were a terrific group. We had a wonderful time. It really was a family. We loved it.
Awesome.
I can't wait to see it. I've been pestering Buddy for the last number of months now, being like, come on, someone's giving me a release date here. Nobody's gonna care.
Maybe.
That's literally that's the same answer that I've gotten off everyone. If I find out, I have to tell people. But I'm hoping that someone's going to know soon and tell me.
Ruth, I wouldn't normally say something like this, but maybe have a word with Buddy to give Greg and Elle screen a copy if he can, you know? Maybe. Yeah. Maybe. I don't know. I mean, in fairness, he is the biggest fan of this film. So, you know, and he will buy it when it comes out as well, so... You know,
I'll wait till they do a double or something.
We can have double features now.
Yeah.
It's now officially a franchise. No, franchise is three, isn't it?
Three, yeah. Well, yeah, well, it's a duo.
Just like the Terrifier.
Exactly.
But that's Friday the 13th. How many do they have now?
67.
Don't go there.
And apart from the first one, most of them are pretty average.
I agree,
but yeah, as I said, we'll wind down. And as I said, it's been an amazing pleasure. And anytime you want to ever come back, if you get cast in new roles, if you want to come on and let us know about it, and we'll promote them for you.
Thank you.
You know exactly where we are.
We're not hard to find.
I was at the other end of either the Instagram page or obviously it was my Facebook that I was talking to you on. And whatnot.
But, just before we go though, Ruth. Excuse me. Again, thanks very much for coming on the show.
My pleasure.
And have you anything coming up that you want to promote play wise or anything at all that you want to kind of tell us about or you know?
Well, once again, I'd love to get involved in more projects. You know, you can reach me on Facebook. I'm easy to find. Yes, I'm in a play that opens on Friday called Blood Wedding at Raleigh Little Theater, but that's about it. I hope to get it more of a chance to travel and enjoy not being in the classroom for a while.
Well, I mean, look, I'm sure all your pupils We're very proud of you. And
I'm proud of them too.
Which is always great to hear. It really is. Thank you again for coming on. And I know I keep saying it, but we really appreciate your time and your conversation. It's fantastic. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Greg, take us home.
We'll do it like we do every Friday night around this time, ladies and gentlemen. In the words of the great George A. Romero, stay scared.
Woo!